I'm a zoologist. Too often people think I study zoos because they hear zoologist and they think zoology. But zoology, folks, is a study of zoos. And I find zoos kind of boring. If I had a chance, I don't go to zoos because they're boring. And so I'm a zoologist. And a zoologist is what? Anybody know what a zoologist is? That's right, somebody who studies animals. And so animals, that's a pretty big field, isn't it? You know, there's a lot of animals out there. So you have to specify. And so when I was in graduate school, I specified the field of invertebrate zoology, that is animals without a backbone, specifically parasites. And so I guess you'd say this morning, I'm a parasitologist. Too often people think I say parapsychologist, and they start telling me about their brother-in-law. It's things I don't want to hear, and it's already too late. They've told me too much. And so I just say that I'm a zoologist, and then they think I study what? Zoos. Okay. So anyway, I'm an invertebrate zoologist. I study parasites. I've conducted research and got my research published in the prestigious, I have to admit, Journal of Parasitology. And that's probably in most of your coffee tables, Journal of Parasitology, right next to Reader's Digest. But the point is, you don't have to go to France to study parasites. Thank you. I'll be here all morning. Okay, so let's go ahead and look at men of science, men of God, the founders of science. And I always like to begin my presentations with Scripture. So it says in Psalm 111, The works of the Lord are great, sought out among all them that have pleasure therein. And the word sought there in the King James means studied by. So the works of the Lord are great, studied by, or sought out of all them that have pleasure therein. And so I like to try and think God's thoughts after him as a zoologist, as a parasitologist. And so, of course, the big question is, Frank, where did parasites come from? If God created everything very good, where do parasites enter into the this whole biblical worldview? And of course, it would take me about, I think 4 or 5 hours to describe where parasites fit into it, because there's a whole bunch of different parasites out there, aren't there? You've heard of nematodes, like hookworm, roundworms, things like that, yeah. And so that's kind of what I study, and we've come up with some really, really interesting conclusions. And so I like to study God's word. I like to study his creation, even though it's been corrupted by sin, to come to some conclusions and come up with hypotheses. Do evolutionists come up with hypotheses? Shake your head like this. Yeah. Can creationists come up with hypotheses? Yeah, you bet. And so which hypothesis is the best hypothesis to have? So, the fear of the Lord, as the psalm, it says in Proverbs chapter 9, is the beginning of wisdom. If you want knowledge, go to college. If you want wisdom, go to God. So, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. The late Henry Morris, who was the founder of ICR back in 1970, when he founded ICR in 1970, I was on the flight deck of an aircraft carrier off the coast of Vietnam. Little did I know that I would come to work at ICR. I was a brand new Christian. I got saved on board that aircraft carrier. And so I was still an evolutionist at the time. And then I read some creation literature and became a young earth creationist, as we say. But it was through the reading of the literature of the late Henry Morris. He said, one of the most serious fallacies of modern thought is the widespread notion, that is the worldview, that biblical Christianity is in conflict with true science, and therefore that genuine scientists cannot believe the Bible. And we'll see in just a few minutes we have together how false that is. The good Bible-believing scientists can make incredible contributions in the field of both the physical sciences and the life sciences. So God's primeval mandate to Adam and Eve is found in Genesis chapter 1. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. So this is a creation dominion mandate. Notice scripture doesn't say that we should just trash the environment, that we should not care for the environment, be wise stewards of the environment. Obviously, we are that. We understand that God created, and we are to be good stewards of what God has created. And that's why I taught my four children as they were growing up not to trash, not to litter, because that is a sin to our creation, our dominion mandate. And so here it is, and certainly that is as true today as it was back then. But what's the difference? Well, the difference is that the environmentalist worships basically the environment. Not all of them, but most of them do, that the environment is everything. And we don't worship the environment, we worship the one who created the environment. So we worship the creation, the creator, not the creation. And Paul talks about that in Romans chapter 1. So we are to be wise stewards, we are to worship the creator, the one who created the environment. Practically all the founding fathers of modern science, such as Newton, Boyle, Kepler, Linnaeus, Ray, George Washington Carver, the list is very significant of men of science who were men of God, who believed in God. They believed in special creation and the Word of God, the Bible. They developed the scientific method of observation and experimentation to study nature. Let me ask a question this morning. Are we as creation scientists against observation, testing, and repeating? Not at all, not at all. So we at ICR like to observe, test, and repeat. That's the essence of what we call empirical science. And we have no problem with that. As a matter of fact, all of the scientists at ICR have advanced degrees in, as I say, either the life sciences and biology or the physical sciences, such as geology. And so when I went to the University of Northern Colorado, I went there to study God's creation, what God has created, even though it's been corrupted by sin, right? Remember the seas of Genesis? What's the first sea of Genesis? Well, that'd be the creation, right? Creation found in Genesis chapter 1, where it says how many times that God created after their kind or after his kind. How many times does it say that in the first chapter of Genesis? 10 times. So 10 times God is telling the reader in just the first chapter of Genesis that he created after their kind, after his kind. And do you suppose that maybe God is trying to tell us something? As a parent, when I want to emphasize something to my four kids as they're growing up, I would repeat myself. I'd be redundant. As I would get the point across to the kids. Don't play basketball in the street. And so I would say that over and over again because I love them and I wanted them to make sure they wouldn't get hurt or injured or anything like that. And so God told us 10 times that he used his word. That he created after their kind. In other words, he told us 10 times, in effect, that he didn't use evolution. And so that's the creation. And then there's the corruption of the creation. That's found in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 1, where Satan, the very first words recorded of Satan, the deceiver, was to question God's authority. Remember what it says in Genesis 3:1? Yea, hath God said? That's what Satan said. The first thing that is recorded in the Word of God is to question the Word of God. And so Eve and listened to the serpent, and then Adam as well, and they sinned, and we are in the situation that we are in today because of our first parents. And so we find that that was the corruption of the creation. And then God cursed the earth, didn't we? There, the third sea is a curse, where he cursed the world with weeds and thorns and thistles and so forth. So that's the curse. So what are the first three C's? Creation, corruption, then he cursed the earth. He cursed the earth with weeds, thorns, thistles. Have you ever heard of mutations? Yeah, mutations are genetic mistakes. And so probably that's where mutations came about when God cursed the earth. Hey, how about parasites? Maybe that's where parasites came from when God cursed the earth. You had these normal, quote-unquote, creatures, and then God cursed those creatures, and they took up what we call a parasitic existence, living in beast and man, but depending on them. And so we hear some very, very terrible parasitic diseases. I could give you life cycles that would curl your hair. But so those are the seeds, the creation, the corruption, the curse. God cursed the earth with weeds, thorns, thistles, mutations, probably parasites, definitely telemarketers. And so those are some of the seeds. And then one of the last seeds found in the book of Genesis is the catastrophe. What's the catastrophe? Just us here this morning. The Genesis flood. So in three chapters, God describes to us in Genesis that he sent a worldwide flood. That's a catastrophe, right? Do the evolutionists believe in a worldwide catastrophe? Absolutely. Yes, they do. Back in the 1980s, a father-son team decided that a giant asteroid struck the Yucatan Peninsula of Mexico 66 million years ago. And that was a worldwide catastrophe with a vengeance. So all of a sudden, since the 1980s, the evolutionists and the creationists believe that there was a worldwide catastrophe. The evolutionists just recently came on the scene with that particular worldview. But we have maintained the Word of God has always taught that there was a worldwide catastrophe. So what are the C's of creation, class? Creation, corruption, curse, and what's the last one? Catastrophe. Very good. And so they developed the scientific method of observation and experimentation, that is empirical science, of which we have no problem with. And so that's what we do at ICR. Many historians, not necessarily Christians, now agree that it took Christianity to start modern science. Most other religions and philosophies do not start out with the notion that the universe is the creation of a rational God. That is where secular scientists actually have borrowed, if I can use that word, from the creation worldview, because it was Christians, it was Bible-believing Christians who kind of set up this investigation, this scientific empirical method. And probably the greatest scientist who ever lived was Sir Isaac Newton. He wrote twice as much about his faith in God and theology than he did about his science, the rotation of its planets and so forth. So the scientific method that we employ today was built on the belief in a creator and his creation. And so we see this, the observation, the testing, and so forth, and repeatability, which is all part and parcel of what we call empirical science. We at ICR, as I like to emphasize, believe in empirical science. We conduct it and so forth. And as I say, all of the scientists of ICR have advanced degrees in science from secular institutions. So we embrace science, we enjoy science, we understand that God has called us into the scientific field. But what do we not embrace? This strange idea called neo-Darwinian evolution. It says that everything came from a single living cell that conveniently existed billions of years ago in a primeval ocean and gave rise to the plants and the animals and people through the supposed millions and millions of years with a whole bunch of beneficial mutations. And so that's the empirical science. Thousands of scientists of the past and present have been and are Bible-believing Christians. The most discerning historians and philosophers of science have recognized the very existence of modern science had its origins in a culture at least nominally committed to a biblical basis. And so obviously scientists today, 99.9% are all secular, they have a secular worldview, but it wasn't always like that. As society has drifted more and more away from its biblical roots, its biblical foundations. The study of the world and its processes is really, as Johann Kepler and other great scientists have maintained, thinking God's thoughts after him, and should be approached reverently and humbly. And that's what we say at ICR. We say that to study science, to study God's creation, well, it's a form of worship. It's a form of worship, and we are reverent as we do our study and our investigation, understanding that in the beginning, God created. This is what young earth creationists try to do with the creation, the corruption, the curse, and the catastrophe that we talked about. So, is young earth creation science a late theological innovation? sometimes the critics of creation like to say that, oh, this young earth creation business started with Henry Morris back in the 1950s. However, that is absolutely false. Let's look and see just how old, if you will, young earth creation is. Applegate and Stump said in their book, no, and quote, young earth creation has been the dominant view throughout church history, held by the New Testament authors, the early church fathers, medieval theologians, the reformers, and 19th century scriptural geologists, all predating the birth of the modern creationist movement. And so this is kind of interesting that young earth creation science goes back so very, very far. It is hardly a late theological innovation. Since Jesus Christ is the incarnate Word of God, and without him was not anything made that was made, according to John 1, it is necessarily true that true science must be built on the knowledge of him who created the world that scientists seek to study. So let's look at some of these scientists in just the remaining minutes we have together. First of all, I'd like to start with a fellow Navy man, a fellow sailor, Matthew Murray. He was an officer in the American Navy, and he was a strong Bible-believing Christian. And I start with him because I was in the Navy for 4 years. So Matthew Murray was a naval officer. He loved the Lord, and he experienced a catastrophic carriage accident that put him in the Naval Hospital on the East Coast for months. And while he was convalescing in this naval hospital after his accident, he read in Psalm 8, whatsoever passeth through the paths of the seas. And Murray decided right then and there from his hospital bed that if God is describing paths of the seas, what? There probably were paths of the seas. And so he claimed Proverbs chapter 16, commit thy works unto the Lord, and thy thoughts shall be established. As he began to study, along with friends of his that he was in contact with, that they would study these paths of the seas. Throughout the 1840s and 50s, driven by his strong work ethic, Matthew Murray contributed to a wide range of scientific and academic endeavors, including publishing perhaps the first modern textbook on oceanography that was published in 1855. It was titled The Physical Geography of the Sea. And that book became very, very popular. Matthew Murray's investigation and research became very popular, and they called him the scientist of the seas, or if you will, the pathfinder of the seas. He was so incredible in his work and investigation that they put up this memorial of him that you can see in the East Coast of the United States. And so the Pathfinder of the Seas discovered most of the major currents that we find in the oceans today. And of course, these currents are incredibly important to maintain the health of the world's oceans. Johann Kepler is best known for his discovering the three mathematical laws of planetary motion that are called Kepler's laws that established the discipline of celestial mechanics. So he loved the Lord and he did the investigation and the research. He had a deep love for Christ and the inspiration and authority of Scripture. He is frequently quoted as saying that I'm thinking thy thoughts after thee. And so he gave God all the credit and all the glory as he did this research into celestial mechanics. And Kepler also made several other notable contributions to science. He was the first to determine that refraction drives vision in the eye, and that using two eyes enables depth perception. We call that stereoscopic vision, as we have these two eyes to measure the depth of something. When light travels through water or a lens, for example, its path is bent, or here's the key word, refracted. Most refraction in the eye occurs when light rays travel through the curved, clear front of the surface of the eye, and that is the cornea. And this is the structure of the eye is what gave Charles Darwin such fits, if you will. He just could not understand how the eye could evolve through time and chance and natural processes. The eye is testament to creation, Romans chapter 1 and verse 20. Well, Gregor Mendel also is quite the creation scientist when he was alive in Austria. He's called the father of genetics, and he formulated the laws of inheritance. His work was rediscovered in 1900 after he died. The story goes that Gregor Mendel knew about Charles Darwin and the work that the naturalist Charles Darwin was doing, and so Gregor Mendel sent his research to Charles Darwin from Austria to England. But there's no indication or record that Darwin either received Mendel's works or commented on them. And it's kind of sad, isn't it? Because Mendel was a creationist. He could understand God's creation. He formulated the laws of inheritance, which, by the way, we use today. And so you have the monohybrid cross, the dihybrid cross, and all that. I used to teach genetics, loved it. And it shows God's creative hand. Mendel entered the Augustan Abbey at St. Thomas and soon began his pioneering work using pea plants. And he crossbred all of these pea plants and came up with some very, very significant empirical research. Robert Boyle, one of the first to transform the study of science into an experimental discipline. Well, Frank, what do you mean by that? Well, a lot of scientists in Robert Boyle's day would do their research, they would conduct the investigation and experimentation, and then what? Just leave it right there. They wouldn't share it with anybody, they would write it down somewhere, they'd come to very interesting conclusions, but they didn't tell anybody else. They didn't tell their fellow scientists. They didn't have any organization or construction of a fellowship or something like that where scientists would get together and compare notes and sharpen each other, as it says in the book of Proverbs. And so it was Robert Boyle who said, you know what, we need to get together and discuss some of these facets. Boyle was a major contributor in the fields of physics and chemistry. And as a boy, he learned Latin, Greek, and French, of course. You know, easy, just the easy subjects there as he was a boy, a young man. He was a devoted student of the Bible. He also produced multiple books and essays on the Christian faith. Robert Boyle, just an amazing, amazing individual. Michael Faraday, he was a very humble man, rejecting a knighthood and twice refusing the presidency of the Royal Society, a very prestigious society there in England. Faraday was an active elder in his church throughout his life. He really didn't sound out his creation science convictions to the public, although he was a good scientist and he loved the Lord, and he was somewhat quiet and reserved about it. But Michael Faraday is known as the father of electromagnetism. He discovered the molecule benzene, which is a very, very interesting molecule, and invented an early version of the Bunsen burner that we've all played with in high school there. And he worked with electromagnetism, as you can see in some of the electromagnetic spectra that are used. And so a mantis shrimp-inspired camera sees polarized light. Why do I mention that? Well, because it all started with Michael Faraday, the father of electromagnetism. And so here's a deep sea mantis shrimp, and it can actually use the polarized light and is able to sense this very unique type of light waves that we can't, but the invertebrate, the crustacean, a mantis shrimp can. Mantis shrimp can perceive wavelengths of light ranging from deep ultraviolet to far red and polarized light. It really is amazing what this little shrimp can do. Each eye possesses not binocular, but one more, trinocular vision, and therefore depth perception. So we're learning a lot from the mantis shrimp. James C. Maxwell was a Scottish physicist credited to be the father of modern physics. His knowledge of scripture from his earliest boyhood was extraordinarily extensive and minute. These things were not known merely by rote. They occupied his imagination and sank deeper than anybody knew. So James Clerk Maxwell, a very, very dedicated Christian and the father of modern physics. George Washington Carver was an agricultural scientist and inventor. George Washington Carver is credited with resurrecting the agricultural situation of the Deep South after the Civil War. He was the one that would talk to farmers and plantation owners in the Deep South and instructed them on the ways of good agriculture. He developed hundreds of products using peanuts, though he didn't invent peanut butter. I was taught that as a kid outside Chicago, that he was the inventor of peanut butter. It turns out that was an urban legend. But he worked with sweet potatoes and soybeans, and he was born as an African-American slave a year before slavery was outlawed. And he, this is a quote that I really enjoy as I read the biography of George Washington Carver. "Never since have I been without this consciousness of the Creator speaking to me. The out-of-doors has been to me more and more a great cathedral in which God could be continuously spoken to and heard from." Wow, that's eloquent. I really enjoy that. So Romans chapter 1 and verse 20 is probably one of my favorite verses as a creation biologist. "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are," what are these two words, class? "Clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made," as we saw just briefly, for example, with that mantis shrimp, "even his eternal power and Godhead." And then Paul ends with a warning, doesn't he, in this verse? This is not from yours truly or ICR or anybody else. Paul says, "so that they are without excuse." Something to consider as we study the creation model. Well, one of my good friends is Dr. John Sanford. Years ago, I'd go jogging with him when he and I would go to these creation conferences in the evening. He and I would go jogging. He's the inventor of what's called the gene gun. At Cornell, Dr. Sanford and colleagues developed the biolistic particle delivery system. Let's just call it the gene gun. He is the co-inventor of the pathogen-derived resistance process and the co-inventor of the genetic vaccination process. And so he's no slouch when it comes to the very sophisticated areas of the biological sciences. And he gives glory to the Lord. After we would jog, we would pray together. It was just wonderful. And so set phasers on stun. Now, this is the gene gun that John has developed. He would take genetic material, DNA, and it would coat a heavy metal, like these very, very tiny microscopic beads that would be coated with DNA, and then he'd literally shoot those particles using a gene gun into a plant, and some of those particles would find their way into the nucleus of a plant cell, and then that DNA that would be on those particles would be incorporated into the genome of the plant. So John Sanford wrote a book called Genetic Entropy, where he says, and the word entropy means that things are going downhill. It's a measure of disorder. And so even the evolutionists were the first ones to use the phrase genetic entropy, the genetic load or a genetic burden. That is that mutations that we accumulate, we're getting more and more as each generation goes on. As we sit here this morning, we have necessarily inherited mutations from our parents. And so we're not getting better and better. We're getting what? Genetically, we're getting worse and worse as we continue to inherit mutations from our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, or just our pretty good grandparents. Thank you. Genetic entropy presents compelling scientific evidence that the genomes of all living creatures are slowly degenerating due to the accumulation of slightly harmful mutations. I end with this individual, Dr. Raymond Damadian. I met him once in San Diego many years ago at ICR. He's the man who invented the magnetic resonance scanner. He is an American physician, medical practitioner, and inventor of the first magnetic resonance scanning machine. He earned his medical degree at the prestigious Albert Einstein College of Medicine and later did graduate work in biophysics at that little Bible college back east called Harvard. And so here Dr. Damadian is, he is standing in front of the first MRI scanner, one that he made. He invented it. He's the one that put it together. Where is he standing? He's standing in the Smithsonian Institution's Hall of Medical Sciences. And so Dr. Demedian is standing in front of the MRI scanner, the one that he put together, and just an amazing, amazing work that he had done. Oh, and here's a 21st century MRI scanner. Can you see the difference between the two? And so I've had MRI, probably half of us in this room have had an MRI at some time. And so it's very, very fascinating and has helped to save countless lives. MRI, the premier medical diagnostic imaging method in use today, is a $10+ billion per year industry. $10+ billion per year. MRIs are able to detect diseased tissue or injury more accurately, safely, and effectively than any other medical imaging technique. Over 1 billion MRI scans have been completed since its invention, with over 60 million additional scans each year. Who invented it? Dr. Raymond Demedian, who is a creation scientist who loves the Lord and has spoken on occasion when it comes to creation science. Dr. Demedian has also been inducted into the National Inventors Hall of Fame alongside people like Thomas Edison, Alexander Graham Bell, or Wright Brothers, where he was awarded the Lincoln Edison Medal. Do you get the idea that this guy is no sloucher, that he has made a very, very significant discoveries, of which he is the one to come up with it first? He was the one that built the machine first. He is the one that did all of this. Unfortunately, Dr. Demedian has experienced a recipient of censorship. In 2003, the Nobel Prize for Medicine went to a breakthrough field of diagnostic MRI scanning. It was shared by two scientists. Guess who was not included with those two scientists? But to the stunned disbelief of virtually all who worked in that field, these did not include Raymond Demedian. Even though the terms allowed for up to three people, it was two scientists, it allowed for three people to share the award, Raymond Demedian was not included. Why is that? Why was Dr. Demedian not included in that group, those two other individuals? Well, it's because he was caught speaking as a creationist, speaking about creation science, like the presentations that you hear at ICR. And because they found out that he was a creationist, they censored all of the work that he did. And it's probably the saddest thing I can tell you this morning, because if anybody deserved the Nobel Prize for Medicine, singly, it would be Dr. Raymond Demedian. Well, to end this on an upbeat note, Dr. Henry Morris, the late Henry Morris II, who went to be with the Lord in 2006, is one who started the Institute for Creation Research out in San Diego. I began working with ICR in 1996. Before that, I was a teacher at Pensacola Christian College, teaching pre-med biology and nursing. And so he was a founder in the early 70s in San Diego. So discover more scientific evidence for creation. Get on our mailing list. If you're not on our free Acts and Facts mailing list, this is the Acts and Facts publication that you'll get each month. I'm very honored and privileged to have my article written on hummingbirds in this month's Acts and Facts publication. So you can go ahead and look at that. Plus, you get a free Days of Praise devotional booklet, which is what I like to call a miniature Bible study each day. So when you get the Days of Praise, it's a devotion for that day, but it is absolutely chock full of good theological, good biblical information. And it's something that you want to get there. So you can go ahead and check out the books that we have, the free publications that you can sign up for in the back of the auditorium. This is Dr. Tim Clary's brand new book, Carved in Stone, talking about the Genesis flood. It's a hefty book, but it is a great read. It's brand new. Tim has done an outstanding job. When he was in graduate school, he got straight A's. I can't say that. but he got straight A's in grad school. Just an amazing, amazing individual. We're glad to have him on board. And so get two of these books, one for you and then one for a friend of yours that's interested in geology and the Genesis flood. This is probably the most, my favorite book out of all the books out there in the bookstore. This, Creation Facts of Life by Gary Parker, a dear friend and my mentor, we go back decades, wrote this book, Creation Facts of Life. It's a good foundational book that helps you to understand what biblical creation is all about from a scientific aspect. And of course, John Sanford's book, Genetic Entropy. It is an outstanding book. It shows that this genetic load or genetic burden that we are all experiencing goes totally against what evolutionary naturalism says. Well, we have some other books as well, books that I have not included on the screen there. These books, for example, is Science and the Bible by the late Henry Morris. It's a thin book. This is a book that you want your kids to read, whether they're being homeschooled, going to a Christian school, but especially if they're going to a public school. Science and the Bible. It shows that science and the Bible go together how? They go together just like butter and bread. Science and the Bible dovetail together beautifully, just like politics and corruption. They go together beautifully, okay? Science and the Bible. But not only that, but wait, there's more. If you call right now, The Biblical Basis of Modern Science by Henry Morris. Now, this is a little bit more significant, a little thicker here, but it, again, helps the student to understand that science and the Bible are inextricably linked. They go together beautifully. And so, The Biblical Basis of Modern Science, this is an outstanding book. I'd love to read this. And then Dr. John Morris, who is the son of the late Henry Morris, and I wrote a book on the fossil record. This copy has been revised, expanded, and updated. I wrote the appendix on it that where I discussed the so-called missing links. The evolutionists say, oh, the fossil record is full of missing links or transitional forms. Well, I took those and I looked up in the secular literature and found, well, as a great American philosopher, Gomer Pyle said, surprise, surprise, they aren't missing links at all. And so it's worth the price of this book just to look at that appendix and see that all of these so-called missing links or transitional forms are nothing of the sort. And so, but this is a good coffee table book as well. This is a book that you want on your, where else, your coffee table, because it has beautiful color plates of the various fossils and all. And it's easy to read. Dr. John wrote most of the first two-thirds of the book there. It's a great book to have in your creation library right there on your coffee table. So these are some of the books that you would want to have in your growing creation library. Now I understand that, you know, expense things get kind of pricey, and I certainly understand that. And so if you were only going to buy one book in the bookstore this afternoon, I understand that if there was one book that you would buy, these are the four books I'd get, okay? Get Carved in Stone, The Fossil Record that Dr. John and I wrote, plus these two must-have books regarding science and the Bible. So those are the books that you want to get, again, for building your creation library. Get on our ICR Acts and Facts mailing list. Read about the fascinating hummingbird. Yeah, just an incredible creature. Everything about this creature shouts design, but I'll let you read all about that. So we'll turn it over to Joel.
Thank you, Mr. Sherwin. Did you guys enjoy that today? Was that interesting? Very good. Well, we've got about 10 minutes or so. We can take a few questions. For those of you watching online, we'll get to as many of those as we can, but we want to give preference here to our guests here in person at the Discovery Center. So if you're here in the audience right now, feel free to raise your hand. I did see a couple of questions that came through on our texting app, and we'll get to at least one of those in just a moment. But feel free to raise your hand if you're here in person, and we'll get to a couple of our online questions as well. So to start off with, we had a question that came in through the texting app.
Okay.
And it was, is the center of the universe a black hole?
Is the center of the universe a black hole?
A black hole.
Boy, that's a great question. What's another question? No. Yeah, so I'm not an astronomer. I study parasites, and so this is a little bit out of my field. And so that's an idea that maybe some astronomers have, some cosmologists, those who study the origin of the universe have. It's very hard to validate because, first of all, we're not sure where the center of the universe is. And so if we're not sure where the center of the universe is, we can't say for certainty that there's a black hole there. Now, I can say more locally, that is our Milky Way galaxy, right? And where is our solar system in our Milky Way galaxy? Anybody know? It's about two-thirds of the way out in one of the spiral arms of our Milky Way galaxy. And so the Creator, in His infinite wisdom, has placed our solar system out in one of the spiral arms of the Milky Way so that we don't get blasted by radiation. I hate it when that happens. And so He put us out in the spiral arm there, and plus, because when you get close to the center of the Milky Way galaxy, we're talking light years, many, many light years, the closer you get, the more radiation there is. And guess what's in the middle, at least they're pretty sure, of our Milky Way galaxy? Answer, a supermassive black hole. So you have black holes, and then you have ones that are really big, and they say it's a supermassive black hole. So that's about all I can address on that. And it looks like most galaxies, they think, probably have a very large black hole in the center.
There's so much to learn about God's creation that we don't even completely understand yet.
Yeah.
So, okay, any questions from our in-person audience today? Anybody? Okay.
No questions about parasites?
Let's go to a question here from our friend Ellie, watching on YouTube, all the way from the great state of Oregon.
Oregon.
And she's asking about mantis shrimp. Actually, not about the shrimp, but she's saying, do you think that there are more undiscovered creatures like the mantis shrimp that could help us make scientific discoveries?
An excellent question. The answer is wholeheartedly, yes, there are. Now, how do I know that? Because we think about the ocean, and the oceans are pretty big, aren't they? Shake your head like this. Yeah, there's a lot out there. What's the average depth of the ocean? 2.5 miles down. 2.5 miles down. That's pretty deep, and that's just the average depth of the ocean. How much of our planet is covered by oceans? Somewhere around 71-73%, somewhere around there. And so answer to her question, how much of the ocean so far in this 21st century have we investigated and researched? Answer, about 6%. And that's a generous amount. Probably it's less than that. We'll say 6%. What does that mean? It means that 94% of the ocean remains unexplored. Well, why is that? I mean, look, we're here on Earth. We've sent landers on Mars. We're going to send another one next year, hopefully that's even bigger and better than the other landers that we've sent there. It's going to have a little helicopter that the lander will launch, and the helicopter will float around in the 1% atmosphere of Mars. How is it we know so much about Mars and the surface of the moon and so little about our ocean? Well, there's about five reasons. First reason is the ocean's pretty deep, isn't it? And with that depth, what do you get? Lots and lots of pressure. But with that crushing pressure, which in itself is prohibitive, what you also have is it's very dark. And so you're going to have your own lights, right? So it's very, very crushing depth. You have to have your own lights. Oh, yeah, it's pretty cold. It's right at the freezing point of water. So now all of a sudden it's very cold, it's very dark, and the crushing depth and all of that. It's made of salt water, right? Well, salt water corrodes everything, and so there's a significant corrosion factor of all this high-tech scientific equipment. But the biggest problem of all is moolah. That's a Chinese term for money. Who's going to pay for all of that? And so even if you're able to work out all those other problems, you still have to find somebody who's willing to shell out the millions, and it's going to take millions if not billions of dollars to investigate and research. And so they have found very, very interesting things in the bottom of the ocean or close to the bottom there, such as the mantis shrimp. But for you young people, if you're good at math, I would suggest you go into oceanography. You have to be good in mathematics, though, but it's a wide open field, and it's very deep.
Oh, my. I love Mr. Sherwin's puns. I don't know about y'all, but I sure do.
Okay.
Okay, and let me put in a plug real quick. He's talking about the mantis, shrimp, and also the other creatures in the ocean. If you're here in the Dallas area, like I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation, we give these presentations each week, twice a week, once on Wednesdays at 11:05. Those are streamed to YouTube, and then we have a second presentation on Fridays at 11:05. And that, again, is free for you to attend. And this coming Friday, Mr. Sherwin will be talking about the wonderful oceans and different creatures that live in the oceans, things that about the ocean that show God's design, ways that the oceans confirm the biblical global flood, and other fascinating things that we can learn there. So if you're here in the audience today and you want to come back on Friday, you're welcome to do that. You don't have to have a ticket. Just show up at 11 o'clock, and we'll start at 11:05, and you can hear from Mr. Sherwin. All right, any questions from our audience in person? Yes, sir. Okay, let me say that for the online audience. Question is, do you think dinosaurs still roam the earth? Go ahead.
I'm pretty confident that dinosaurs probably are all extinct, but I can't. Can I say that generically? Can I pound the podium and say all dinosaurs are extinct? Well, I can't do that scientifically, because remember what science is all about. Science is observation, testing, repeating, getting out there and looking, right? Has anybody with 20/20 vision gone out there and thoroughly investigated every square foot of this planet? Answer, no. And so there's a lot of the planet that has not been thoroughly investigated and researched, and so we cannot definitively say that dinosaurs are extinct, but probably they are. But what's just as exciting as finding a live dinosaur? Finding soft dinosaur tissue. And so with these dinosaur fossils that we occasionally find, by the way, what's the most common fossil? We've heard about fossils, right? What's the most common fossil? Something like that? Not even close. It's marine invertebrates, otherwise known as clams. And so really the most common fossil, 9 out of 10 fossils in the fossil record are marine invertebrates or clams. And so in that remaining 5% or so, or even less, are dinosaur fossils such as you see here. So we have the fossils, and we have soft dinosaur tissue found in the dinosaur fossils. And so probably we won't find any living dinosaurs, although, you know, we have to keep the door open just a crack. So that's always a good question.
I know where there is a dinosaur that's still roaming around. In our exhibit hall, there's a T-Rex. Have you seen that one yet? Okay.
Good.
Yes, we have a T-Rex in there. It's animatronic, and I won't spoil too much about it, but he's pretty impressive and somewhat lifelike, I would say, too. So check that out. We've got time for one last question right here. Yes, ma'am. Are alligators dinosaurs?
Yeah, that's a good question. Are alligators dinosaurs? The answer is no, they're just reptiles. Now, when you look at an alligator or crocodile, you look at their morphology, which is their shape, and their legs come out like this and go down, don't they, right? You've seen them, they kind of walk kind of funny, don't they, as they're chasing you, you know, because you just finished eating some chicken or something like that, and that gator's running after you, and his tail is really swinging as they run after you because of the structure of their legs. But what about a dinosaur? When you go into our hall of dinosaurs there, you look at its morphology, their structure, their legs come straight down like this. And as far as we know, we haven't seen any dinosaurs walk like this, but the idea is we're 98% sure that's how they walked, right? If they had legs designed by the creator like this, well, there are 80 tons of steaks and roast. You know, what would happen? They'd be dragging their belly around like an alligator, and that wouldn't last very long. So God, in his infinite wisdom, has designed dinosaurs to walk straight up and down like this, you know, the dinosaur walk. So, and also one of my favorite quote-unquote dinosaurs, I have to be careful I say this because I don't know who's watching on YouTube, One of my favorite quote-unquote dinosaurs, and I'm using that in quotation marks, is the Komodo dragon in the South Pacific. And that's not really a dinosaur. It also is a reptile, but boy, they're savage. And when they feed the Komodo dragons on one or two of these South Pacific islands, they'll come up in a skiff, a boat, and what do they have in the boat? Deer. And they'll let the deer off onto the beach, and the deer will trot happily from the beach into the forest, never to be seen again. And so that's what the Komodo dragons eat. And so